a musical about a boy in a dress written by Robbie Williams. Hello, welcome to vlog 45. It's Christmas! Nearly. Anyway, I'm going to go right back to the beginning of the month because I'm a little bit behind on myself. I've had such a busy time, I've not even had a chance to make my vlogs. So there's been a bit of a delay, but anyway, here goes. So, at the beginning of the month, I went to see White Christmas at the Dominion Theatre. Now, this is a transfer from the Curve Theatre where it was last year. Starring Dan Burton and Danny Mack from Strictly Come Dancing, they are back with the gorgeous Claire Hulse, who was recently in the cinema screening of 42nd Street. She's got her tap shoes back on for this incredible and very festive show. Joining the cast in replacement for Monique Young is Danielle Hope, as well as Brenda Edwards, who takes over from Wendy Mae Brown. Now, Brenda was last here at the Dominion when she was playing Killer Queen in We Will Rock You. And it's great to see her back. She is a gorgeous human being and a damn fine actress. And this show is brilliant for her. It really showcases her wicked sense of humour. Now, as for the show itself, it is a bit of a threadbare story. Very similar to 42nd Street in that there isn't much that happens. It's a bit of a kind of behind the scenes and based on the film. But it is a feel-good festive romp. And you will come away smiling, especially when the snow falls right before the finale. Now, it's being choreographed by Stephen Meyer, who recently worked with Matthew Bourne on Mary Poppins. And Stephen's trademark brilliant choreography is exemplary. It really does elevate this show into a spectacle. The ensemble are brilliant. And like I say, yeah, there's not much of a story, but it is a fantastic show with fantastic performances all round. After the show, we went to the after party at this bizarre hotel. I shouldn't say that, but it was a bit of an odd location for a press night. Split across many levels, it was quite hard to kind of navigate around and catch up with people, but I did see a few of my old friends, which was lovely. Now, White Christmas has already announced that it's going to be on tour next year, which is fantastic to get it out across the country, spreading the festive cheer. After the after party, I ended up in Freedom with a few of the cast spinning around those poles until the early hours. Tuesday, Tuesday afternoon, I was at the new workshop presentation of a brand new British musical called Papadopoulos, based on the film of 2012 called Papalopoulos and Sons. The film was self-produced and distributed by writer and director Marcus Macau, who again has written and produces this new musical adaptation of the film. Bringing in Australian music producer and writer John Femus. He was famous for working with Boy George and Culture Club, and recently even wrote for the likes of Kylie Minogue and Jerry Halliwell. And sticking with musical theatre, he wrote the show Taboo. Now, there was additional music by three other writers, so it's not all down to John. And the music is okay. I've not seen the film, so I don't know how it compares, but I imagine there's not much discrepancy. The cast were incredible. Led by Anthony Costa and Heba El Shaik, they did a really, really, really good job. And my old buddy Caroline Kay was part of the workshop as well. Presented at the Other Palace for one performance only, this is exactly what the Other Palace was designed and intended for. And the guys behind this really did seem to want to take on board any feedback to move this project forward. So I completely commend them and look forward to seeing what happens next. On a Tuesday evening, I went to see Rage But Hope at the Streatham Space Project. Now, this is my first visit to the Streatham Space Project, and it is a lovely, lovely little venue with a huge auditorium. Now, Rage But Hope is a new piece of writing by Stephanie Martin in response to the Extinction Rebellion movement, and tackles the subject of climate change. Brilliantly told through eight separate characters who each have a monologue, the characters range from a young 12-year-old girl right through to an old lady, and shows the differences in their perspectives when it comes to climate change. It's a brilliantly well-researched and informed piece, with a lot of humour threaded through it. And it really does engage and make you think. Stephanie Martin is brilliant. And it is one of those pieces that was only on for 1 week, which is a shame because I could definitely, definitely recommend it. The show was directed by my own pal, Scott LaCrasse, and he does a very, very good job. It was one of those productions where I, even though I knew a bit of insight and knew what was going to happen, I was still swept up and engrossed by it. The acting across the board was incredible. Fantastic. Well done. After the interview, I grabbed some of the audience to hear what they thought about the show.
I mean, what a phenomenal piece! It was brilliant, completely unlike anything I expected. Oh my God, so good. I loved it.
It's provocative, urgent and interesting, funny.
Mind-blowing.
I really enjoyed it.
Not seen anything like this.
So immediate, something that's responding to something that's happening right now.
So it was very clever.
The writing was amazing.
It's got a depth and attention.
Quite dramatic as well.
It's a night at the theatre that I haven't experienced in a very, very long time.
It makes you think, makes you laugh, makes you angry, it makes you sad.
Joyful and hopeful and despairing and everything all at the same kind of time.
But it also makes you very impassioned and very motivated to do something.
So I think it's really important. It does feel like sort of news night in the theatre.
Yeah, I like that, news night in the theatre.
Some really, really standout actors.
Good stories, well told.
Yeah. Very human. I think Steph Martin writes incredible monologue.
Everyone in the audience could relate to each character that came on stage.
You can see people that you recognise, even if you don't know them personally, that person who would participate in a movement like this. You see that that's a real person.
It educated me on things I never knew about, to be honest.
So thought-provoking.
This is affecting people in 100 different ways that I've never considered before.
So there's lots of very important issues around race, privilege, intersectionality.
This is a piece of theatre for absolutely everyone.
Everyone. I want all my friends to come and see it, and my family.
I think all of us should come and see this play.
Ah, oh, everyone.
People that are interested in the idea of climate change need to come and see it.
Doesn't matter who you are, where you're from, what you think about climate change, whether you're a denier, whether you're an XR member, go see it and have a discussion.
I think we all need it.
Just anyone, because it is an issue facing our time that involves everyone.
Are you a human? Do you live on planet Earth? Do you rely on planet Earth for your existence? If you answered yes to these three questions, then you should come and see the show.
It's a show that you come out and you want to talk about.
I'm really, really, really pleased I came.
And a full video of the audience responses can be found on my YouTube page. On Wednesday, I was invited to interview the cast and creatives of a new workshop called Funny Girls. Written by Rob Smiles, this tells the story of what might have happened backstage when Barbara Streisand and Joan Rivers once worked together in an off-Broadway production. Now, it is loosely based on fact. Barbara and Joan did indeed work together once upon a time. And what Roy has done is studied these two women to kind of come up with an idea of what perhaps they might have spoke about backstage. It's a very funny piece with a lot of brilliant one-liners and is pretty damn representative of Joan and Barbara. You can really see their personalities coming through thanks to the brilliant work of Debbie Chazen and Victoria Yates. Now, Debbie was in Calendar Girls and is going into Rags the musical at the Park Theatre next year. So look out for that one. Here is a sneak preview of some of the footage I shot when I got to interview them all.
10 years ago, I produced a play called Curtain Sid at Trafalgar Studios, which was about Kurt Cobain and Sid Vicious with Danny Dyer. Is that the right way around? Yeah, right.
Yes.
With Danny Dyer and Sean Evans. And the writer said, oh, I've written another play. And I was like, okay. And then I read it and I was like, that's pretty good. And then we hadn't done it. And then I just decided this year that it would be quite a good time to see what we could do with it.
You sent it to me and I read the first three pages and I couldn't stop reading it.
It's basically because Streisand and Rivers were vaguely friends back in the late 50s because they did this dreadful show. I just thought it was a nice premise for a two-hander and they could just unleash all manner of hell on each other.
Funny Girls.
So from Calendar Girls to Funny Girls.
Only do with things with girls in. It's in my contract.
So you are playing Joan Rivers.
I am, yes. Lifelong icon of mine.
Is she? Amazing.
Yeah, she told it like it was. She was a proper, she knew how to speak the truth. Or not the truth, but it was just funny.
So you're moving on to Victoria, so you're playing...
Babs.
Yes. Another icon.
Isn't she? Oh, I love her. Yeah, I mean, again, it's not, you know, an impersonation, but I've been watching a lot of videos, films. Unfortunately, I say to my husband's like, what are you doing today? Just watching Barbara Streisand films. Sorry, I've got to do it.
What an excuse.
I know.
So, Vegas, eh? You got to play Vegas.
Yeah. Great, isn't it?
Not too shabby.
And it was sold out again tonight.
Well, pretty sold out. There were a few seats empty.
There were no empty seats.
Just a couple.
Every seat was sold.
A couple of people didn't turn up.
I could see the whole joint from the stage. There wasn't a seat left.
I think they let some of the bar staff take them.
It was goddamn sold out. What's the matter with you?
So it was sold out. You want to quieten down?
What kind of person comes backstage to tell me there are empty seats?
That's your husband, apparently.
Oh, I would if he could.
And the full video will be available in a few weeks' time. I really liked it. It was presented as a rehearsed reading in one of the function rooms at the Coliseum, and a specially invited audience were brought along to give their insight and feedback. Again, this is a brilliant way to make theatre happen. starting right at the beginning, engaging with an audience and seeing what they make of it. And it will really help to develop the piece in the long term. Straight after that, I hopped in the car and drove all the way to Stratford-upon-Avon for the press night of The Boy in the Dress. The much-anticipated new musical by the RSC, based on the novel by David Walliams, which has already been adapted into a film for BBC. It has now been given the RSC treatment. Now, they are the guys behind the hit show Matilda, and you can tell that they are obviously hoping for a similar hit with this new production. They have brought in Guy Chambers and Robbie Williams to write the music, which definitely shines a spotlight on the production and will probably get a few bums in seats just because of their names. Now, the cast is brilliant, and my good friend Charlotte Wakefield steals one of the parts playing a very funny French teacher. Playing the dad is Rufus Hound. But the stars of the show are the children, who are fantastic. I really enjoyed it. I can't say it's as good as Matilda, but it definitely stands its own ground. There is some beautiful staging, beautiful costumes, and the music is actually quite catchy, as you would expect from Robbie Williams and Guy Chambers. Being based on a children's book by David Walliams, it does have all those fart jokes that you would expect from David Walliams. And within that, it definitely appeals to kids and adults. And the night that I went, the children in the audience were loving it. There's no doubting that this show will come to the West End and will probably tour the UK after that. And it will do well because it does tick all the boxes. I managed to catch up with my friends Charlotte Jacoby and Charlotte Wakefield after the show for a couple of drinks and spoke to some of the other cast as well. On Thursday evening, I was back at the Old Vic for this year's production of A Christmas Carol, written by Jack Thorne, who wrote Harry Potter and the Cursed Child. This is back at the Old Vic for its third year running. It originally starred Rhys Ivins and last year Stephen Tompkinson. This year, they've cast an actor of colour, Patterson Joseph, who is brilliant. And it does give a slightly different flavour to the show. The show is exactly the same, hasn't changed. And if, like me, you've been every year, you'll be quite happy with that. Because if it ain't broken, don't try to fix it. And this is a magical, magical piece. Perfect for Christmas. They give you mince pies and sultanas when you arrive. And like White Christmas, real snow falls at the end of the show. This is a beautiful adaptation of the classic novel and is brilliantly staged and superbly performed. Joining the cast this year as well was Olivia Winner, Rebecca Traherne, and she is incredible. What I also love about this production is each year they give opportunity to children in special circumstances to play Tiny Tim. And the night that I saw it, a little girl called Eleanor Stollery was playing Tiny Tim. Eleanor lost her sight due to a brain tumour and is now completely blind. And it is beautiful to watch her perform and be guided around the stage by a very supportive company. It really does tug on your heartstrings. And she was fantastic. Also, the Old Vic has finally completed their refurbishments and their newly installed toilets. And there are no complaints from me. Straight after that, I went along to the Boulevard Theatre to catch Natasha Barnes' very own finale evening. I love Natasha Barnes. She is exceptional as an actress and a singer, but she is also very, very funny and so down to earth. She gave us a few songs from shows that she's been in, as well as songs from shows that she tried to get into an audition for, but never quite made it. And her stories about these auditions were hilarious. She was joined by Natasha O'Brien, Lee Mead, and my gorgeous little buddy, Alexander Lodge. Here are a few songs from the evening.
Here, take my Kleenex, wipe that lipstick away. Show me your face, clean as the morning. I know things were bad, but now they're okay. Suddenly Seymour is standing beside you. You don't need no makeup, don't have to pretend. Suddenly Seymour is here to provide you with sweet understanding. Seymour's your friend.
Treated me kindly, Daddy left early, Mama was poor. I need a man, and I'd follow him blindly. He'd snap his fingers at me, I'd say sure.
You're top man on scene. You don't think life comes in between. But hey, she's just 17. Yeah. She feels that she's a worldly girl. Man, you've been around this world. She's just some worried daddy's girl. Even though there's nothing I can say, it's human nature anyway. But let her down easy, her heart is on a dime. Let her down easy, and you'll grow up in time.
That's a lie.
Woo-hoo.
That's what people say. You're riding high in April, and you shut down in May. But I know I'm gonna change their tune when I'm back on top in June. Some people get their kicks stepping on a dream, but I just can't let them get me down. Oh no, 'cause this big old world keeps spinning around.
Bye.
Friday the 1st of December, it was World AIDS Day. And I went along to a special evening hosted by the British HIV Association. Accompanied by my pal Wallace Despres, the evening brought together a range of people to talk about experiences of living with HIV in the UK. And these were not what you would typically expect. As well as Jonathan Blake, the formidable man who is in his 70s and has been living with HIV since 1982, there were also guest speakers from trans people living with HIV, straight men, and Muslim men, as well as women and African Caribbean women. And it is such an eye-opener to recognise and realise that HIV affects so many different people across the UK. It was a really brilliant evening to raise awareness and to help celebrate these formidable people living with this condition. And also, now on World AIDS Day, I also launched my series of interviews with people living with HIV within the theatre community. And I started with the brilliant Stuart Saint, a formidable producer and cabaret star who was very generous to talk to me about his experience living with HIV and working in theatre. Thank you for watching. That's normally how I sign off my vlogs. But if you're watching this, then that means you're already helping me to make a difference. I'm Philip Dehaney, and I've been making That Stagey blog for nearly a year. During that time, I've met and interviewed some incredible people. And this month, I will be meeting some of the most remarkable. In this series, I will be interviewing people from the theatre community living with HIV and people who have spoken publicly about it. Each of their stories is very different, as is the way that they choose to tell them. Some people are able to talk publicly about it. Some people prefer to stay private, and that's okay. I hope that these videos will encourage you to listen and to talk. And whether you want to share your story with somebody, I hope that these videos will encourage you to start those conversations. I hope that these videos will answer some of your questions and encourage you to ask more.
Well, yeah, what I'm trying to say is that I am HIV positive.
When I did the video and I saw people's responses, I was like, oh, you don't have to do anything like on a massive ramblage, you could post one video and you're helping. Or at least you could tell somebody and then you're helping, whatever you do.
Because I didn't have the knowledge, it was a big pool of fear.
I had no reason that person would be me. I had never thought that I would ever be HIV positive.
I'm really proud of what I've done now. But the fight continues.
I discovered learned that I was HIV positive. It was October 1982. I couldn't believe it. I was 33, you know. My life was only just beginning, and here I was being given a death sentence.
Now, this story is based on the not just your story, but the group of you, isn't it, really?
Yeah, no. The film is based in fact, but Stephen has woven this amazing tale. And it is incredible.
The minute I met Jonathan, I thought this guy has got to be a character. He was so charismatic and flamboyant.
He really played a key role in winning the hearts and minds, not through political dialogue, but through personally being who he was.
When he told me that one of the things about him that became famous in the Valley was that he loved to dance. I knew that there was the potential for an amazing filmic moment.
There we are, all dancing. And this is me. Stephen has created this dance for Dominic West, who plays my character.
It could very easily not fit into the film, but it does, because it moves things along and it advances the themes.
I love Dominic's performance in the film, and he really captures that sense of what Jonathan was all about.
If I had ever been able to dance like he dances, I would have been a very happy lad.
God, I miss disco.
So Mr. Jonathan Blake.
Yeah.
The legend, the man, the legend.
Oh, no, yeah, I just...
the poster boy.
Poster boy, yeah, I'll go with the poster boy. The legend I find kind of sort of, you know, I'm not dead.
Well, no, that is why you're a legend. You defied.
Yeah, that I defied them.
We should insist as a basic right for every person living with HIV, no matter where they are in the world, that they should have access to treatment.
So the good news is your gonorrhea is easily treatable.
Can I have a test for HIV as well?
Sure.
I'm executive director of an organisation called NAM Publications, and one of the things which we do is provide information about HIV through our website AIDSMAP.
And the rest of that interview can be found on my YouTube page. Please do check it out. So that's it for that week. If you got to see any of the shows, I hope you enjoyed them just as much as I did. And I look forward to seeing you soon.